So we're here in San Francisco, and so you're Marc Canter.
Yeah.
So what are you doing here?
We started a new company called Interface, and we're here at the Wearable Worlds Accelerator, and we're going to join their portfolio of companies and use this offices as our base for our new startup, and we're going to be raising money, and they're going to help us find money.
So what did you do before?
So my background is that I started a company called Macromind, and that became Macromedia.
And so what have you been doing since then?
Wow. So between 84 and 92, I started Macromind, that became Macromedia. And then in 92, I worked with Todd Rundgren and a director named John Sanborn, and we created interactive music videos. We called that the Media Band. So this was a live performance, this was a CD-ROM, and this was going to be an interactive TV content programming, okay? So this is between 92 and 94, where the music and the interactivity jammed together with the video, and you'd click and change the way the songs were. It was totally awesome, pre-web kind of stuff. Then in 95, I did an interactive TV talk show, which was an experimental project working with online stuff, again, before the web, because everything we were doing was high res, okay? And so then I started working on the notion of a media bar, which would be an interactive location-based entertainment system, right? And you'd walk up to the bar and you could log in and play games, music and video jukebox, order food and drinks, cruise around the web, because by 96, 97, the web had come along, right? And the whole thing was based in my home on Potrero Hill. And we made 25 nodes at my house, right? Because the problem was there was no such thing as broadband. So we were doing broadband in a closed loop way, right? All right, so that project, we almost did a deal with Apple. Apple, this is right when Apple was going down, so that whole deal fell apart. So then we started working with a company called On Command. They do the boxes in hotel rooms, and that never worked out. But we did get a gig at the Super Bowl, okay? So Super Bowl 32, which was in January 1998, we did 600 flat panel displays. We could do touch screen, and you could go back and forth on the instant replay on different camera angles. Nice. And food and drink. This is in 98, right? So that was part of the choice seat system. Then we were contacted by a company that was working on a digital city project in Trieste, Italy. Il costruzione la digitale città in Trieste. Io faccio a pendolare a Trieste e San Francisco. So I commuted between San Francisco and Trieste, and we were building this digital city project. That's right when the Telecom Italia hostile takeover happened, that whole deal blew up, right? So I came back to the States, and we worked with a guy named Richard Lee, who's Li Kai-sheng's son, based out of Hong Kong. So this company was called Pacific Century Cyberworks, and they were working on a simultaneous live television and web portal. So as the words would go onto the teleprompter in the TV studio, and you're reading the article, so would the main article on the web portal change. So we did the whole development system for that. This is all doing things despite the fact that the web was too slow. Okay? So we were doing kind of hardwired broadband things in the 90s. That led us to developing these JavaScript routines in these in the web browser page, which later became called AJAX. So what they called AJAX around 2003, 2005, we were doing that in 98, 99, okay? So I'm always kind of ahead. Interactive music videos was way ahead of Guitar Hero and Dance Dance Revolution. So I've always been doing things that are kind of cutting edge. In 2002, I had an idea for what I call the Community Commons project. It was an early form of social networking. I pitched it to a guy named Mark Pincus. He had just put money into something called Friendster. Okay. So then he started Tribe.net. So I was one of the original guys at Tribe. Dana Boyd was there. Other people were there. And so we developed, throughout the aughts, I did social networks. So I created a white-labeled social networking company. Clients we had were Mondadori out of Milan, the Times of India out of India, the U.S. Army, ROTC program, the Sacramento Kings, NVIDIA. All these big companies hired us. I worked with Condé Nast, with AOL, with EMI in London, building social networks for people. Now, most of them never came out. Most of them failed, right? Because Facebook won and everybody else lost, right? So I was building all that stuff, and in 2009, I left San Francisco after 21 years in San Francisco, and I moved to Cleveland, Ohio.
Why?
Now ask me, why would I move to Cleveland, Ohio? Because it was the most unlikely place to go, the worst place in America, where unemployment and what we call the Rust Belt had really completely decimated the economy. So I wanted to go and get rid of technology and start over and say, what can I do as a person to help create jobs? So I worked on a project called the Digital City Project. I've been flying around the world pitching this project. I went to Jamaica, Tampa, Lafayette, Louisiana, Kansas City, where the Google Fiber project was coming in. I went to Amsterdam, Kuala Lumpur, pitching this new system that I had developed, that was trying to develop. I needed to get money for a pilot. Failed. All right, so after 5 years in Cleveland, moved down to Charlotte, North Carolina. So that's where we are now. My wife works at Wells Fargo because I'm virtual. I'm an entrepreneur. You know, I go to Amsterdam a lot or Hong Kong, whatever, but I'm still basically an American. So I'm working out of Charlotte. So for a while, I was an acting CEO of an Internet of Things company. And I won't mention the name because the company was a disaster. But what happened was I clued into the Internet of Things. And I read my friend Robert Scoble and Shel Israel's book, The Age of Context. And I realized that this was the next evolution in computing, the balance of man and machine. This was something so big. And I noticed the same problem that we had back with Macromine and Macromedia, the same problem exists today, which is that the technology is so difficult to use. How could the creative people, the educators, the scientific people, the marketers, how can they ever participate and build Internet of Things apps and experiences? So that's when we decided to start a company, and we call it Interface. So that's why we're here at Wearable World, to get Interface funded.
So let's get up and let's see what's going on here.
Great.
So what's going on today?
Okay. You want to do a walkthrough?
No, just to...
You want to walk while you talk?
So today is...
Okay. All right, ready? And you want to walk in?
Wearable World.
Okay, you ready?
Yeah.
All right.
So...
Okay, so today is Wearable Wednesday. What we're here is we're at the Wearable World Accelerator in downtown San Francisco. What we're going to do is have a panel discussion, and all the portfolio companies from the summer class of Wearable World. Here's some entrepreneurs over here in the corner. We're going to have a presentation later on today. And then we've got various Internet of Things products that are being demonstrated that various portfolio companies have. So you see this new kind of game controller, or smart controller. Goggles and glasses. Startup.
Nice.
Oh, want to tell us about your startup?
Groundery Start?
Yeah.
Here it is.
Who am I talking to?
Maybe somebody's shooting some video about Wearable World.
We are going to be an international e-commerce marketplace for connected devices. So we're going to be probably pretty much the first consumer-facing, come and get the latest and greatest smart products.
So people can buy them there.
They can also pre-order. So the niche we're serving is post-crowdfunding. You finish your crowdfunding campaign with your IoT, your wearable product, you need the next step. Where do you go? You come to Crowdrooster. We are life after crowdfunding.
You're making it happen.
Ah,
is it launched already? Is it available?
We are launching soft launch next week. We're using this time to onboard our first customers, and that's going great. So yeah.
We're onboarding as we speak.
So what's the vision right here? What do you want to do right here? What's going to happen now?
Well, okay, for tonight or in general?
In general.
Okay, so like this is an accelerator dedicated to the Internet of Things and to wearables. So last week when Apple announced the smartwatch, that became a very big thing in this world. So tonight they're going to talk about the rise of the smartwatch. Okay? So this is the hot scene where people are involved with Arduinos and little bits and building DIY projects and printers, where they meet the fashion industry, they meet the social psychologists and the various new kinds of entertainment. And this organization, Wearable World, is very much like the next generation TechCrunch or GigaOm. Okay? What they are is they put on live events, okay, and they put on monthly events all around the world. So they have an event coming up in London called Glazed London. It's on October 23rd, okay? And they will be at all the major conferences. They're working with Demo this year. Because, you know, Internet of Things is about to... Oh, here's the information right here. All right, so there it is, Glazed London. The next, they do Wearable Wednesdays. Okay, they're involved with all the different conferences and stuff that just came back from Vegas. So this is one of the hottest new topic areas around, and that's the
all right,
scene
so,
here.
Yeah, so about that company you just started, do you want to do... Do you want to enable easy hardware hacking? What's going on?
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to create new kinds of apps. Okay, the apps, what we're going to call them, smart apps, right? And what you have at your palette, at your disposal, is all the different devices and things in the smart home, okay? Now, those devices have natural kind of activities that come with the device. So the lock can turn on and off, right? You can turn the light on and off, all these kind of natural things. When you have a Fitbit or a Jawbone, you're counting how many times you move and what you do. What we want to do is take it to the next stage. What happens if you want to use your Fitbit for something other than exercise? What happens if you want to create some hot spots and zones in your house that you want to educate your kids with and create fun educational things using these smart objects, right? So what our interface tools will be is a new kind of publishing platform, all right? So we see it as the next generation of personalized publishing. So it started with blogging, then it went to like Tumblr, then it got up to Instagram, and we see it continuing forward, creating smart apps. So our authoring tool will allow you to upload video and text and images and audio, to use Spotify links and SoundCloud links, to build interactive pages designed for the smartphone or for the tablet. And then as I create a hotspot, so example on this desk, I could have different hotspots, and as I go touch something, that could trigger a page, trigger a photo, trigger a video. All right, now you as a technical person, you understand what I'm saying, but the trick is you're not a programmer. Right? So what we're going to do is build in the capability of doing two kinds of interactivity. One is things that happen when the user clicks it. It's what's called a foreground activity. So, you know, it puts up a button, click, start this video. Put up a survey, collect the information, etc. Foreground activities, okay? But also we'll give the ability to author background intelligence, you know, something that's monitoring something and watching something and tracking. And if this happens, then that happens, right? So the trick of all this is to understand the context. So what we do is we collect, the author creates this app and he collects information about the end user, Facebook, profile information, what gyms they exercise at and who their friends are. And all this information is plugged into the system. And then you can create little simple authored sequences that monitors and says, if it's raining, then our running club should be moved to an indoor gym. Right? Something like that. So the IFT model, the same model that everyone's been using, is if this happens, then that happens. Okay? And that's great. But the point is that IFT really is only creating a very simple trigger and action thing. We want to create a much longer kind of a sentence, more involved with the particular nouns and verbs and prepositions that are used in your real life. This is my list of my friends, and if my friend is available for extra time, then book me a time with her, with this trainer, or, you know, if this is happening and I go over to this location on the geolocation, then trigger that. I mean, all these kind of scripted, authored sequences that we believe a whole new kind of customer will want to do.
So you're making an OS for the smart home?
Tools. It's not an OS. Tools.
Tools.
The tools create apps. The apps are smart. So the interface tools create smart apps.
Nice. How soon can we see this in everywhere, in products?
Okay, so if someone wrote me a check tonight, in 1 year, we'd have an MVP. You know what I mean by MVP? Minimal viable product, right? So it's like, I got about like 3 years, 4 years worth of ideas, but you got to hone it down to what's like version one, okay? That's called MVP. Now, the reality is, the way we would develop our software is that after 6 months, we start to put into the hands of guinea pigs, experimental users, authors. And this would be at schools, at different organizations, different agencies. Because remember, there used to be something called a Flash developer. And they would have these agencies. You'd go to this company and they would build the Flash thing for you. Well, these people are all looking for new kind of tools to create new kinds of experiences. So after about 6 months, we'll start to be able to get the tools into the hands of these users. Then the trick is that they tell us what they want, and then we give it to them, right? So let me tell you a funny story. Back in the day, in Macromine, there used to be something called Macworld, right? So we'd put our programmers into the booth at Macworld, and they would demo the product. And customers would come up who had the earlier version of the product. They'd say, man, I've been using your product. It's great. Can you get it to do this? And the programmer would go up to the hotel room, and he'd come back the next day with the feature.
Right.
So that's we were doing that kind of stuff 25 years ago. So nowadays it's called agile or lean or whatever you want to call it. This is just how we've always developed software. So we fully intend to engage directly with our users, our authors, build them what they want, and look for how to make those tools generic so they can be used across lots of different application areas.